This video is sponsored by Lomi. Depending on where you live, you either love heat pumps or barely even know what they are. The heat pump is nothing new. In fact, odds are you almost certainly have one in your house right now. But what if I told you the next 5 to 10 years, companies are going to start heat pumping all the things? Everything from whole house heating to water heaters, pool heaters, and even your clothes dryer. In fact, it's already starting to happen and it's going to be awesome. Here's why. By the way, this isn't our first video on the venerable heat pumps. If you want a deep dive on how they work, check out our other video linked in the description. But the TLDR version is this. Heat pumps are all the rage right now because of their efficiency. More specifically, their coefficient of performance. You see, conventional electric heaters are essentially 100% efficient, and natural gas heaters are above 80%. Efficiency, then, is of the input energy. How much of it is actually converted to heat? 100% is pretty good, so how can a heat pump possibly do better? Unlike conventional heaters that actually produce heat, heat pumps just move thermal energy around. Remember when I mentioned all of us have a heat pump in our homes already? Well, your refrigerator and air conditioner are both examples of heat pumps. Both of these systems desire cold, so they pump heat outside, leaving their insides cooler. For heating, we just need to run the refrigeration cycle in reverse, bringing heat energy inside and pumping colder air outside. By doing this, no new heat energy is created. Well, technically, the compressors and pumps of a heat pump do generate some heat into the system. Therefore, if an electric heater can take 100 watts of energy and produce 100 watts of heat, well, a heat pump can use 100 watts of energy and provide 300 to 500 watts of heat. Yeah, they have a COP of between 3 and 5. Now, this is all good and well, but why should any of this matter to you? Well, the short answer is energy costs, which have been a bit crazy lately. A global pandemic, and now a war. Let's start with natural gas, which, while really expensive in Asia and Europe, is relatively cheap here in the US. Being the world's largest natural gas producer, most American homes rely on it for heating. Here's a chart showing just how dominant natural gas has been by region. You'll see that the use of electricity for heating is on the rise, and generally natural gas is declining. But something interesting is happening. Most countries have natural gas reserves, and much like your checking account, the goal is to keep the gas being pumped in close to the levels of the gas being consumed. However, the US has been operating on a deficit on its 5-year average levels. Ironically for the US, all the reasons for this are climate change related, at least indirectly. Winter Storm Uri in February of 2021 caused such cold weather that natural gas prices skyrocketed and even led to issues with natural gas power plants. It's not just cold weather that's the problem. As more coal power plants shut down in favor of natural gas, record-setting summer months and increased AC usage also result in higher natural gas consumption and prices. My natural gas prices are insanely high here in San Diego. In 2022, due to concerns over shortages in supply and demand, my utility raised my rates 50%. And in my most recent bill, I used 45 therms of natural gas, which cost me $94.19. All in, that's over $2 per therm. But what is a therm, you might be asking? One therm is 100,000 BTUs, or British thermal units. One BTU is 1,055 joules, so one therm is 105 megajoules. Before you tell me how stupid our units are, remember, British thermal units, so blame them. I'm kidding. But I agree, our units are kind of ridiculous. But I still maintain, Fahrenheit is better than Celsius. Come on, 30 degrees is freezing, 50s is brisk, 70s are amazing, like it is in San Diego, and 90 degrees is really hot. 25 degrees Celsius, is that good? But I digress. The only thing I hate more than my natural gas prices are my electricity prices. During the same billing period, I used 1,012 kilowatt hours and paid $459.92. I feel ridiculous even saying that out loud. By the way, Earth Day is coming up, which is a perfect segue to our sponsor this week. This is Lomi, a ridiculously cool, beautiful kitchen electric composter. If you do any amount of cooking, I'm sure you're familiar with this. Food scraps from vegetables, fruit, even coffee grounds and eggshells. This isn't trash, it's the basis for future plant food. But usually it takes months to break down. But with Lomi, you can take this and turn it into nutrient-rich dirt in just hours. Using Lomi twice a week can reduce your waste footprint by 50%. It has three modes, an eco mode, which uses just around 1 kilowatt hour of energy, and takes 3 to 5 hours. Use grow mode, and in 16 to 20 hours, you have nutrient-rich dirt that's perfect to turn back around and add to a garden or a houseplant. There's even a Lomi-approved mode, which can break down Lomi-approved bioplastics. Whether you live in a small studio apartment or a farm, convert your food scraps quickly into dirt with Lomi. I've had mine for over a month, and I still get a kick out of seeing the results every morning. Use my link, links.pella.earth/RickyApril, to check out this revolutionary new product today. Huge thanks to Lomi and to you for supporting the companies that support the show. But I'm starting a series on building a fully sustainable house. Everything from solar power and batteries to full water and rain capture, growing my own crops, and especially heat pumping all the things. So over the next 2 years, I'm gonna make the following changes to my house. I'm gonna ditch my natural gas water heater and instead get a heat pump water heater. I'm gonna ditch my gas clothes dryer and instead get a heat pump clothes dryer. And change my natural gas pool heater for a heat pump pool heater for my pool. I also wanna switch to a heat pump for heating my house, but I cover that in great detail in my first heat pump video in the description. Let's start by doing some shopping for a new water heater. By the way, one of the most sustainable things you can do is do energy efficient upgrades when your old appliances go bad. So if you have a newer water heater, you should probably just wait until its useful life is up before upgrading, or maybe sell it secondhand to someone hoping to save a couple of bucks. Looking at HomeDepot.com, I came up with the following three water heaters for comparison. One is electric, one natural gas, and one heat pump. Looking at the price tags, the first drawback of the heat pump water heater becomes really clear. It's expensive. Now, all three of these units are 50 gallon in capacity. The electric is the cheapest at $540 US. Next is natural gas at $680, and the heat pump is a whopping $1,700. So then why do I think heat pump water heaters are a good thing? Well, even though they have higher upfront costs, they use a fraction of the energy to operate. Here is a breakdown on yearly energy consumption and operating costs, average for the US and specifically for me in San Diego. Based on the US average prices for gas and electricity and the price difference between these different units, here's the data. Switching from natural gas to a heat pump pays for itself in just 6.4 years. An electric to heat pump in just 3.7. But for me here in San Diego with our Looney Tunes prices, the numbers are just 3.9 years and 1.5 years respectively. Okay, so real talk. When I started research for this video, knowing how high our electric prices are, I thought I would have to end my ode to the heat pump with a big but. But it doesn't make sense for me. But I was wrong. Getting a heat pump water heater could actually pay for itself in just 4 years. And this is really good news because my current gas water heater is really old and inefficient and needs to be replaced sooner than later. There is one consequence worth bringing up. Being a heat pump, while the water inside gets hotter, the room it's sitting in will get colder. Here in San Diego, our hot days vastly outweigh our cold, and the garage, being an unconditioned space, has always been the hottest part of our house. So when I upgrade, I'll get the side benefit of cooler, less humid air in my garage. Of course, this also means a colder garage in the winter, and if you live in a colder climate, this is something to consider. But the heat pumpery doesn't end here. The next appliance I want to upgrade is my natural gas clothes dryer. Now, this one will be a much lower priority for me because I have a nearly brand new gas dryer. But heat pump clothes dryers are a perfect example of how prolific heat pumps are about to become. Heat pump dryers are still relatively new, but they have some really key benefits. For one, they're ventless, which means you don't have to have any kind of a vent running out to the outside to duct out the hot air, which would be really convenient for me because my house does have a vent, but it's over 100 feet long. And as a result, it was applying too much back pressure. The clothes weren't drying properly and the motor would burn out eventually. So I had to run this hose out the door until I figured something else out. If I get a heat pump electric clothes dryer, I wouldn't have to deal with that at all. Also, because they use the refrigeration cycle, they rely on condensers to remove the water and require much less heat. This means lower temperatures and less damage to your clothing, meaning they'll last longer. But this lower heat level also means heat pump dryers, at least today, are typically much smaller in capacity than their electric and natural gas counterparts. The smallest electric or gas dryer I could find was about 7 cubic feet. In contrast, the most popular heat pump dryer at Home Depot maxes out at only 4 cubic feet. Heat pump dryers also take longer per load, so if you have a big family, kids, or do laundry constantly, that might be a limitation. Some models of heat pump water heaters and dryers can run on 110 regular wall outlets because they're so low energy. But typically you'll need a 240 volt outlet, and if you don't already have one wired up, you'll also have the added cost of hiring an electrician. Being as heat pumps transfer heat to the surrounding air, you'll also have air filters to check on probably once or twice a year to clean to ensure healthy operation. In my last home, I had a tankless natural gas water heater, which I thought was the coolest thing. That was before natural gas prices started to soar. And now that I'm trying to build a sustainable home, I want to move away from natural gas. So what about a tankless electric water heater? Those are a nightmare. Let me explain why. A tank water heater has the luxury of using less energy over a longer period of time and storing that heat. A tankless water heater has to take water and heat it in a matter of seconds, which means they use an insane amount of power for short bursts. In the case of an electric tankless water heater, systems capable of producing water for your whole house can use up to 35 kilowatts of power. That's like charging 4 electric cars on level 2 chargers at the same time. The problem with this isn't just money, it's the impact on the grid. First of all, you'll never have enough solar power to cover that massive spike. And second, massive spikes in energy are an absolute nightmare for grid operators. If we want to have a chance for a future of clean energy, we have to spread out our usage and try to level our consumption. Just imagine millions of people taking showers and seeing a gargantuan spike in energy usage. It would be a total disaster, even if it was only for 5 or 10 minutes. No, the future is really clearly coming into focus. Heat pumps, baby, everywhere. I should also mention I have a pool, and I'm also going to replace my gas pool heater with a heat pump, but subscribe and stay tuned for a future video. The heat pump is simply the most brilliant way to electrically heat the stuff in our houses. Just imagine they are 3 to 5 times better at producing useful heat than their counterparts. This matters today, but it's really going to matter in a couple of years. Many new construction projects are being built without any natural gas hookups. And to keep energy usage low, heat pumps have to be part of the answer. Cities like Berkeley, where I went to college, go Bears, and San Francisco and New York have already banned new construction from having natural gas. But others looking to take similar strides are facing major opposition. 20 states with GOP-controlled legislators have passed so-called preemption laws that prohibit cities from banning natural gas. In California, next year's building codes will require all new construction to require running the necessary electrical circuits to allow for heat pump water heaters, leaving builders to decide if they really want to then also pay to provide natural gas lines. The war for the future of heating is heating up. And the battle lines are starting to be drawn. But if you want to see a future free of natural gas, well then, heat pumps are your best friend. Like I said, we have a series of future episodes planned, which we'll link in the description once they're available. But in the meantime, you absolutely must go check out this video.